the common thread, in my view, is that in order to get people on board with these kinds of agendas, you have to cultivate that very primal human fear of being ostracized or socially rejected for speaking your mind. And when we stop talking about what's on our mind, we're actually kind of regulating public opinion. When you start self-silencing, you create the, you know, what's called a spiral of silence, where the majority opinion gets kind of sidetracked or ridiculed or whatever, so that you create the illusion that it's a minority opinion. And then pretty soon everybody wakes up and says, whoa, what happened?
Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morris, founder and president of the Ruth Institute. My guest today on this episode of the Dr. J Show is Stella Morabito, who has written a very interesting new book called The Weaponization of Loneliness. And it's a book about psychological warfare and manipulation. Stella Morabito, welcome to the Dr. J Show.
Thank you for having me, Dr. J.
Well, great, listen, congratulations on your book. This is an important and timely book about just psychological manipulation and propaganda, I guess you could say. Before we dive into the text of the book, give people just a little bit about your background that got you interested in and qualifies you to talk about these topics of propaganda and manipulation.
Sure. Yes, I've always been interested in these issues, in how things like ostracism work, and how people self-censor. So I guess in terms of my background, I have a graduate degree in Russian and Soviet history, and that's what really kind of opened my eyes to how reigns of terror really operate, and the common denominator of it all tends to be this, what I call the weaponization of loneliness, isolation, isolating the victim or isolating the populace in a sense of atomization, and in order to control them. And this is a basic thesis of Hannah Arendt, if any of your listeners are familiar with her epic book called The Origins of Totalitarianism.
Yes.
So, then I worked at the CIA after I got my degree in Russian and Soviet history. I was there during the 80s, the Cold War era. And during that time there, I worked on media analysis, communist media analysis and propaganda, and how they use disinformation. So, that's my professional background, but I never stopped, even when I, resigned to raise a family, I never stopped my interest in these things and started to track how things were happening in the same kind of level in the United States, in terms of all the different issues that do tend to isolate us from one another.
Yes. But I think it's when you and I first met, we were both concerned about the issue of the redefinition of marriage.
Yes.
And you were writing on that topic and I was writing on that topic. I was concerned about, and we had a number of friends, we were, kind of writing about this and working on it. I was concerned about the impact that redefining marriage was going to have on children. And
yes,
you were noticing the way in which the psychological campaign was being waged, the way the propaganda worked, mm-hmm. and so on and so forth. So that's how we got to know each other. We've known each other, I guess it's, 2010 or 2008, somewhere in there, I want to say is when we met. So this book, what I'm seeing here in this book is the result of, years really of your study and thought about these techniques and how they're used and stuff. So let's just start with you. Tell people, what's the big idea of this book? And who did you write this book for? Who's your target audience here?
Yes, well, the target audience, of course, we all like to write for general audiences, but I guess people who are really tuned in or trying to tune in to what is happening around us. I mean, all of these strange agendas, how did they, you know, how did they even take root? And one of the things that I've always looked for is a common denominator, a common thread. And I mean, you look at what's going on with, you know, the insanity of the of gender ideology and transgenderism and what's happening with children. And you know, you can go on like critical race theory and all kinds of strange dogmas that would not have occurred to most Americans even just 5 years ago or 10 years, certainly not 10 years ago. And, you know, marriage plays into all of that, you know, the so-called, you know, marriage equality. But the common thread, in my view, is that in order to get people on board with these kinds of agendas, you have to cultivate that very primal human fear of being ostracized or socially rejected for speaking your mind on certain issues. And, you know, this is not a new thing. I mean, there's one chapter in the book where I trace the use of these techniques throughout history since the French Revolution. So this is not new, but it's something that I think we really need to understand consciously. People need to become a lot more self-aware of how these phenomena, how these dynamics affect us psychologically, and how it can create a kind of what they call a cascade of self-censorship. And when we stop talking about what's on our mind, we're actually kind of regulating public opinion in a sense, because when you start self-silencing, you create the, you know, what's called the spiral of silence, where the majority opinion gets kind of sidetracked or ridiculed or whatever, so that you create the illusion that it's a minority opinion. And then pretty soon everybody wakes up and says, whoa, what happened? You know, 2015, Bruce Jenner, Chris, you know, Caitlyn, and, you know, all this stuff seems sudden, but it wasn't. It's been going on, as you know, this has been going on for a long time, decades, at least generations, really.
And the thing that I think is helpful about your book, that, you know, I want to underline this at the very beginning of our conversation, is that the thing that's helpful about this book is that you, Stella, are helping people pick out the patterns, so that when people can invent new lies and fake research to back it up, they can do that all day long. And by the time you go, oh my gosh, what did they just say? And oh my gosh, that study can't be correct. By the time you do that, they've moved down the pike to the next one, right? So to discredit the whole process, it's very important that people can interrupt that before it gets so far down. Because if you have to track down every single fib they might make up, you know, you're going to be here all day. You know, you're always going to be behind. So the weaponization of loneliness is a key point, but there are other structural things, other patterns that I want you to help people to understand. So you just mentioned that this goes all the way back to the French Revolution in some respects. Obviously, any means of communications that they had then are now all on steroids because of the electronic time. But pick out one or two things, you know, that you think you feel like you can trace back that far. The use of a technique or something. Just give people.
Oh my. Yes. Well, there's always an attack on private life, especially family, bonds of loyalty, and religion. And I, you know, that's, I think, whether it's conscious or not on the part of these tyrants, it's because private life, you can't control what's you know, what's said in the nest of the home, and you know how people perceive the world, and so during the French Revolution, for example, you had them tearing down statues. You know, we saw a lot of that in all of the chaos, especially in 2020, toppling statues. They were changing the calendar. They were renaming streets. They were renaming places and schools and everything. And it's like an erasure of cultural memory. And you will see that same pattern, whether, you know, from the French Revolution, they have the de-Christianization campaign, you know, that was a direct attack on traditional religion, and the Catholic Church hasn't really I don't know that it's ever recovered in France from, from that. And then you had the, and if you go on to the Bolshevik Revolution, it was pretty blatant war on private life, same thing. Mao's Cultural Revolution. I mean, I highlight some of these utopian totalitarian radical revolutions throughout history and look at the patterns.
Yeah, and one of the important patterns is the erasure of cultural memory. So that instead of you being able to look back and say, those are our ancestors, these are the founding fathers, these are the revered people who founded our town or who did heroic deeds years ago or something, instead of looking at that, you'd have nothing to look at. And then what fills that gap, Stella? There's a point to doing that. You know, when they take down Robert E. Lee, that's one thing, but when they take down Frederick Douglass and Abraham Lincoln, there's something else going on here, right?
Oh, absolutely. It creates a vacuum. I mean, the idea is to create a vacuum and then to fill it with ideology or dogma or utopian, requirement, that everybody have the same narrative going through their mind. And I mean, we saw the same thing in the Nazi, the Third Reich. This is how these horrible things happen when people self-silence and the erasure of cultural memory, as you said, is a big part of that because, I mean, when you can't really trace your genealogy, your history. I mean, one of the first things that in the French Revolution, they went into the tombs of the monarchs and, poured this corrosive lime on the corpses. And you saw the same thing. The tomb of Confucius was during Mao's Cultural Revolution was dynamited. It's all kinds of erasure of memory to fill that gap, that vacuum, create the vacuum. And yet, what's very interesting is all these utopian revolutions, all of these, totalitarian revolutions, they can't get anywhere unless they present themselves as sort of a pseudo religion. I mean, you'll see this time and again, deification of, Mao, deification of Hitler, deification, all the, there was even a book a couple of years ago written about how to be a dictator. Where he talks about Frank Decoder. It talked about this whole deification thing. So you fill the vacuum with nothing else but that narrative. The issue now, though, is that everything has changed with the technological revolution. The scale is not regional like it has been in the past. It's global. And the tools are exponentially more powerful in terms of communication. But they don't really have what we would call a charismatic leader at the moment. It's all of these like heads of, tech billionaire hedge fund managers. You've got, they all seem to be on the same page, but they all have their own special interests. But you got the Great Reset thing going on but no one particular like leader of it all. But that's what's different. But all the, like you said, all of the, the methods, the processes, the dynamics are the same, the mechanisms and the goals. And the goals are the same, except now it's on a global scale to, everybody fall in line.
And I noticed that the examples of totalitarian systems that you talk about comprise what most people would think of as both the right and the left, right? So the whole concept of right and left doesn't exactly work. The issue is it totalitarian or is it something less than totalitarian? Does it have more modest aspirations for human life? But if somebody's got totalitarian aspirations, whatever their fantasy ideology utopia looks like, that part doesn't actually matter very much, right? That's the cover story. I think you would agree with that. The issue is how deeply into your mind are they trying to get? And that's where you, really see it. So talk to us specifically about the weaponization of loneliness. Talk about loneliness and why that is so powerful and how that social isolation gets used.
Well, I think as your listeners and viewers would agree, we were created for communion. We were created for communion with God. We were created for communion with each other. In the book of Genesis, this is my epigraph for the whole book, is it is not good for man to be alone. We have a primal, hardwired need to connect with one another. And on the flip side of that is we do have a fear, a very primal fear of being cast into the outer darkness. So loneliness, and I think it's been proven on a, you know, scientifically, whatever, you know, physically can have huge effects on our health. I mean, it can lead to premature dementia and heart disease and stroke. I mean, if you're in severe state of isolation, these kinds of things happen. And of course, we see it with the mental health crisis and the suicide rates and the deaths of despair. Isolation is probably the most powerful weapon that can be wielded. And that's why I believe a lot of prisoners consider solitary confinement the most, you know, horrible punishment.
Right.
You know, you go haywire, you go absolutely, well, feral, even if it's very severe. And I, you know, in my prologue, I talk about the case of this feral child that was isolated. But the threat of ostracism, as anybody who's been in like a public middle school or typical one understands, if, you know, there are certain things you don't say, if you don't want to be ostracized, and certain people that, you know, you don't connect with, or, and I, you know, I think this happens on every level. I mean, you know, it happens one-on-one with, you know, like the gaslighting partner tries to control the social contacts from like the movie Gaslight, if you saw that with Ingmar Bergman, you know, of the you know, the victim, but you also, it happens with cults. If you, you know, the most famous example was Jim Jones, when he isolated 1,000 of his recruits in that jungle in Guyana and had them all commit quote revolutionary suicide in 1978. I mean, and what was the weapon? Well, he isolated them in the jungle, and it's always isolation. Isolation is the first. The first necessity for social control, or a state of isolation, alone together. I mean, you can all be, the worst feeling of isolation comes when you're around a lot of other people and you feel like you're not connected to them. And that's on a grand scale, we call that atomization, you know, when we're kind of in our own separate, you know, fearful and distrustful socially, speaking our minds, you know, you don't really have a healthy public square, civil society. And it's very destabilizing, extremely destabilizing to the human person to be put in that kind of a state of isolation. So when I say the weaponization of loneliness, I mean the exploitation of that fear to push through agendas that wouldn't see the light of day otherwise.
Right. And I think our viewers can fill in the blanks for themselves, some of the things that you're really talking about. Once I started thinking about this, I started being more cautious about what I said, even about my political opponents, because I'm wondering, you know, we don't know who's behind all this, right? Like you said, there may be a smoke-filled room with people, you know, who are plotting and scheming all this stuff. There may be, but we don't know who's there. We don't know who they are. We can tell they're up to no good, but we can't tell exactly, you know, what it all is. There are people that you would traditionally consider on the left who are waking up and going, what the heck is going on here? You know, while people on the right are like, you know, hello, welcome to our world. We've been dealing with this for a long time. But still it's just, like you said, it's destabilizing. You can't look out there and say, hey, I know what's going on, and so I can go about my business and do a comfortable life. That's not exactly how things are when you can't really speak your mind, and, you know, there's this atmosphere of distrust.
Well, when it does come to the question of, you know, who's behind it and all of that, you know, there is there's obviously collusion. I mean, you see big media covers for all of these crazy agendas that folks in, you know, the big government, or you call the deep state, are invested in. We don't really have a particular, you know, villain or whatever. We can't really pick apart all the pathologies, you know, but there are a load of pathologies and how they interpret, if they're kind of leading you down a garden path, or, you know, what we really need to do, I think, is just be aware of the dynamics and, you know, speak to one another, like one-on-one, mm-hmm. more often to kind of like, I'm not really crazy, you know, so a lot of people, you know, especially if you live alone and don't have strong family ties, that's, you know, another one of my running themes is the war against the private sphere of life, because sphere of life, family, faith, and community, true community, which comes from family and faith. The three prime mediating institutions that are our buffers from the tyrannical mass state have always been on the chopping block, or always been the target, because if you read dystopian fiction, you find that over and over and over again. People are isolated, atomized, isolated against one another. And I guess the issue right now is not so much to try to pinpoint a particular villain. There are plenty of them, many of whom know not what they do, I think.
Right.
But to just prayerfully understand what we're up against, you know, the principalities and powers, and do our best to expose that.
Yeah. So tell us about a couple of more of the techniques, Stella. You know, you've mm-hmm. explained about the atomization and the isolation, which leads to self-censorship, which leads to the spiral of silence and everything. There are other things that are being done to us that we might not be aware of that are having similar kind of impact. Tell people, you know, a few other things that they should be on the lookout for.
Okay, well, I have part of my thesis is what I call the machinery of loneliness, mm-hmm. That seems to always be at work. And it's operated by those, whether it's witting or not, it's operated as a form of social control to isolate. And the fuel is our conformity impulse. And the spark, or the ignition of that machine, is our fear. And so that's how I try to kind of illustrate it. So the conformity impulse has that sort of ripple effect as people self-censor, others self-censor. But a lot of the components of the machinery that can be used by bad actors, we know today as identity politics, political correctness, and mob agitation. I call that the three-legged stool of tyranny. They've always existed. I mean, you know, mm-hmm. you go back to French Revolution, same thing, identity politics, you know, counter-revolutionary and all of these other utopian revolutions. So the identity politics, you know, where you are not on board with the narrative is always there. And then political correctness is like the kind of the enforcement tool. I mean, it really helps tyrants or totalitarians when we self-censor. It really cuts out their workload. They don't have to do as much direct censorship. If we're always in fear of saying something that might offend, and we just do their work for them by self-censoring. And so that's what political correctness is about. And then the real heavy duty enforcement arm of it all is mob agitation. And, you know, how do you create mobs? Well, mobs generally, if you look at how they, you know, come together, whether, you know, in any of these kind of revolutions or, you know, whatever kind of agenda is being pushed, it's usually atomized people. It's usually, you know, if you have strong family and faith and community, you're far less recruitable for mobs or gangs or cults. That doesn't mean that they can't reach out and try and get you, but But, you know, that is it's a buffer, you know, having that private sphere of life. So other components of the machinery, I call it like snitch culture that comes out of that. The criminalization of comedy, which is
Oh,
really
let's
awful.
talk
You
about that. Let's talk about
yeah.
that. Let's talk about humor because today humor is well, you can see that the overlords are joyless, you know. I mean,
Oh yeah.
right. And they go after the Babylon Bee, and of course everybody thinks that's even more hilarious. You know,
Yeah.
when the Babylon Bee is more accurate than the New York
I know.
Times, you know. But so talk people through why is comedy, why is humor so dangerous that they have to control it?
Right. Well, in you know, in our everyday life, what is comedy when you think about it? It's what helps us get a sense of perspective on what's true. And laughter, real laughter, is kind of like the release of a pressure valve. Like, yes, that's right. That's what I think too. Isn't that funny? And we've lost a lot of that with you know, clampdowns and censorship on and political correctness. I mean, even I think it was almost 20 years ago, Jerry Seinfeld said he wasn't working college campuses anymore because, you know, they didn't appreciate comedy or too politically correct. And that was Jerry Seinfeld, and that was like almost 20 years ago. So it's gotten really bad. And so if you look at the what I call the criminalization of comedy in places like you know, Stalin's Soviet Union, I mean, it wasn't even, I mean, telling a politically incorrect joke would definitely get you thrown into the gulag, you know, the education camp or worse. But even listening to a joke without reporting or laughing, God forbid, at the joke would get you much more severe punishment. I mean, this is a road we really don't want to go down. We want to turn around because it just gets really bad. And so human beings need that release. And to live in a humorless society with humorless leaders, it's really awful.
And so what we need is a comedy offensive, right? You
Yeah.
know, an attack. We need to get off defense and go on offense with just ridicule these people. And I think that actually works in the sense that then it shuts them up. It shames them in some way. And I think we still have scope for that. You know, unless you're working for a big corporation or, you know, something that's really hooked into the whole, I don't know, corporate global, I don't even know what to call it. But anybody who can needs to ridicule the thing, right? Whenever possible, because
Oh yeah, but I mean, you need talented comedians to really, you know, really stand up. It's kind of interesting. I'm not on the same page as this guy David Chappelle in a lot of ways, but it is funny how he pushes the envelope. I don't know if you've seen him, but where he refers to the alphabet people. Oh my goodness. When he said that, the alphabet people, you know, that everybody just kind of nervously, but you know, they couldn't help but laugh because we
Right.
all know what's going on there.
That's right.
And some, you know, and I think it's helpful to have someone who's not all, you know, not all on the, you know, but known as a quote conservative, doing that as well. You know, because they've got whatever you want to call it, you know, extra cred. But it's really important to kind of cultivate a revival of comedy, a revival of humor. I mean, people are hungry for it.
That's
I
true.
mean,
There are times when I have been aware of a sort of Sovietization of our culture, in the sense that sometimes people paste things into their stories in order to get credit, get some kind of social credit for the fact that they've done something politically correct, but it doesn't really belong there, you know. And the one example that I remember is when Disney remade Beauty and the Beast. From the cartoon version to the human version. And there were a couple of things that were in there that were supposed to be pushing the envelope of gay stuff, you know. And
which one was this Disney one?
Beauty and the Beast, the
Oh.
human version, you know, there was supposedly, you know, there were a couple little things that were supposedly gay friendly. When you looked at it, though. And so when I went to see it, I thought, oh, gosh, what's this going to be? But when you saw these little things that they had put in there, they didn't fit into the story. They didn't advance the story. They were like paste-ons, you know. And so yeah. I wondered, you know, is this like the greengrocer and Vaclav Havel's little parable, you know, that he puts that little sign there in the vegetables saying people of the workers of the world unite or whatever it is.
Right.
He says it in order to make people leave him alone, but he doesn't really believe it, you know. And of course, Havel is trying to say, throw the darn thing away and don't do it, you know, and stop going along with it. But I really wonder, you know, these people who seem to be at the top of this whole pyramid, do they really mean it, you know?
That is a good question. Yeah. Do they believe their own propaganda?
Right.
Is the big question, always is the big question. And I think there is a point at which, you know, even if they don't believe it at first and it's just all a social control thing, they do, you know, when you're so totally immersed in it and invested, that's the thing. Mm-hmm. Very invested in it. They do come to believe their own propaganda. I don't know how many of your listeners, I really love that you brought up the greengrocer yes. parable that Václav Havel, if your listeners aren't aware, was the president of the Czech Republic, but previously was a dissident in Soviet era Czechoslovakia. And he wrote a very famous essay, very long essay called The Power of the Powerless. Mm-hmm. And that's where he talks about how in the private sphere is really the most powerful, you know, it's where most of the power of a society lies in the, you know, family connections, relationships, community. And what we learn there from one another is what ripples outward to create a civil society. And the greengrocer parable was about, you know, he took the example of the guy in a Soviet bloc communist country. He's got his little shop and he's got workers of the world unite. And it's part of what Havel called the panorama. Okay, so it's there. Nobody really pays attention to it. It's all part of the narrative, but everybody accepts it. And the greengrocer knows that if he were to take that sign down, he'd have a heavy price to pay in terms of his job and his reputation and everything else. Even though nobody really notices it, if the sign is taken down, then that is the statement. And right. That's going to get him in trouble. So that's why, I mean, today is an important day. It's election day. And that's why it's so important that, you know, we won't get to that point. You know, we already have, and a lot of people lost their livelihoods for, you know, not, going with the vaccine mandate and things like that. But we haven't quite gotten to the point of, you know, being dragged off to camps or whatever, but, you know, there is a certain point of isolation and atomization where there is kind of a point of no return until it all crashes. I mean, right. Eventually it burns itself out, but the damage that's done in the interim is what, you know, we're always so concerned about.
Right, right. And you know, I recently interviewed Yoram Harzani, who has a very interesting book about conservatism, and he makes a point about honor and people honoring each other, and within, and that society is built up of groups of people, families and tribes who interior to themselves have systems of honor, right? So your mom and dad expect you to do certain things. And if you didn't have your mom and dad backing you up saying, yes, I honor you for what you're about to do, the idea that you would go against absolutely everyone and no one would honor you, no one would respect what you're doing, that there was no little subgroup anywhere that would pat you on the back and say, that's what they're looking for, right? That's what the totalitarians are really looking for. But right. If you've got the family, if you've got the private group, if you've got, you know, even, you know, a handful of dissidents, whoever they may be, you know, you can think in your heart, well, gosh, if Havel was alive, he would honor what I'm doing. Or, you know, John Paul II were watching me right now, he would honor what I'm doing. So you have, at least in your mind, you have the idea that this is worth doing. It's worth taking risks for. It's the right thing to do. What would my father think if he were alive? Oh, does that ever haunt you, Stella? Well, I mean, my father fought in World War II. His brothers, my uncles, what would they think if they were alive and saw what's going on? And so that thought, can bolster us, right? That can stiffen our spines to say, okay, so there is somebody who's going to honor me. Even if there's nobody around right now and I can't see them right now, I know this is the right thing to do. Kind of a thing. But I guess that goes back to your point about tearing down the past. If all of your parents were, all of your ancestors were automatically bad, automatically counter-revolutionary, automatically racist, then you can't look to them for solace. I'm just making this up right now, Stella. You just put this
no,
in my
but yeah, I think it, no, I, no, I think you're right. It's a form of isolation, not just in space, but in time.
Chronologically.
And very destabilizing. I mean, when you don't, this is one of the reasons why we're concerned about, what happens to children when they're separated deliberately by design from one or both of their parents.
Yes.
They're cut off from, knowledge of being part of this generational the timeline.
Right.
And their genealogy and everything else. And so it's very destabilizing. And you're right. We have to, and we honor the past. We honor those who fought for freedom and, the ability to think out loud, in a society that's a healthy society.
But, when you think about it, and another thought that came into my mind as we were talking about it, I don't know how closely you follow transgenderism. I suppose most people on our side of the street know that this is really a very bad thing. It's orders of magnitude worse than a lot of other things that we've seen. One of the aspects of it that, maybe a lot of our people don't know is that these rapid onset gender dysphoria teens, right? They come home with a new name. And the phrase that they use is, do not use my dead name.
Yeah.
That name is dead to me. And when you think about it, the idea that you can give yourself your own name is itself destabilizing, right?
Yeah.
Because you don't pick your ancestors. You don't pick your name. And mom and dad picked out that name probably with a lot of thought and maybe to honor somebody in the past, right? And for you to come home and tell your parents that I'm dead to that name, that's huge. That's a huge blow.
Oh yeah.
For isolating that child, really. You're standing, the child now is standing there with their own self-created identity. By definition, they're attached to no one.
Right. And absolutely. And I don't think it's all that self-created. I think it's imposed from the outside. We might even say that they have assigned this identity, the way the left or the transgender lobby has always cultivated this social contagion, really.
Yeah.
And that when you say rapid onset, it's all social contagion. I mean, the kids more than anything really want to be accepted and part of, whatever's happening now or whatever's going to, and in some cases will give them what they think is a reprieve from being bullied. So if they could belong to a protected class, I think that's part of it as well. But you're absolutely right. I've been following transgenderism for a very long time. It was all part of the T and the LGBT, really.
Right.
It was all part of the same package. And I noticed that. And I started writing about that about a dozen years ago. One of the things I noticed is they have used this phrase. They have embedded for decades now this phrase, sex assigned at birth. And I noticed that right away. I started writing about it. And that was in all of this legislation, whether it was on the municipal level, the state level, and even on the federal level, before they had the so-called Equality Act, the Employment Non-Discrimination Act with the gender identity thing. There were 10 Republicans who signed on to that, clueless about the premise that your sex was, quote, arbitrarily assigned to birth. And, right. you know, really very destabilizing. So, right. But you're right. I mean, this is it's demonic. It's just awful what it is.
And when you, particularly when you look at the teens and how the psychology of the teens, the trans-minded teenager, social contagion, you use that phrase, but I think loneliness, isolation, social isolation is a big part of the process.
Absolutely.
And I think this is why I'm sure you've observed this, that the autistic, the disproportionate number of kids who are on the autism spectrum, who are you know, choosing the trans identity. And what's happening is these are kids who feel socially isolated, and they mm-hmm. feel that this is the solution to their problem. They will now fit in with this new group that is telling them, oh, you really are a boy. That's the problem. That's why you're uncomfortable. It has nothing to do with you being on the autism spectrum. It has nothing to do with that. It has to do with you being born in the wrong body. And here you can come be friends with us. So that's a very seductive package. That's being presented to them. I think it fits your thesis exactly, right? I mean, they're afraid of being alone. Here's the solution to your loneliness. You know, come join the cult.
Yes, and here's the great irony of a lot of it, including the transgender thing, but across the board, as we seek relief from isolation through our conformity or compliance with the agendas and narratives, as we seek relief by, if we think we're getting it through conformity and compliance, we're dead wrong. We are going even deeper into loneliness, even deeper into isolation as we comply with these agendas. That's a great irony. I mean, they use the fear of isolation to, you know, they exploit that to, you know, for social control, tyrants in general. And as we comply, the big bonus for them is that in addition to our compliance, we become even more isolated mm-hmm. because that's what our self-censorship and compliance does. You think about it, censorship, political censorship is so insidious because it really cuts us off from one another when we feel we can't speak our minds to one another at all. I mean, a neighbor or, you know, a friend, and yeah, maybe they disagree, but there was a time in this country, you know, you disagree and you could still be friends. And right. that's really changed. So anyway, that's great irony is built into that whole machinery.
Right. Right.
That it just keeps generating more and more and more isolation and loneliness. Mm-hmm. And the only way to stop that is to stop self-censoring. And that can be a tall order the farther down you are in that,
yes.
down that road.
And, you know, in the last part of your book, you talk about the antidote to the weaponization of loneliness. And you have some mm-hmm. very specific suggestions for people, in addition to speaking out, which of course that's implied in every page of the book. It's implied, you know, that you need to speak your mind and you need to be brave mm-hmm. and be courageous and so on. But you have some very specific suggestions towards the end of the book. Would you share some of that with us, Stella?
Sure. I think there are, you know, three basic things. When I say, you know, speaking out, obviously everybody has a different situation. I mean, I wouldn't want someone to just blurt out something that's going to cost them their job like immediately. Learning how these processes work on us. And so that's number one. I don't know if that reads forward to you, but
that's
the cover of my book.
That's great.
Yeah,
I didn't see the cover. I didn't see the cover. You sent me a PDF.
Oh, yeah.
We have a cover.
We've got Fauci scolding us, and he basically represents the weaponization of loneliness of this COVID era. Mm-hmm. And so anyway, that's just the, you know, that's my book. But number one, yes, becoming aware of these dynamics. And there are different ways we can do that. And one way is through building parallel polices or parallel institutions. All of our institutions have become so subverted and corrupt. And one way to build them is, I took a note from Václav Havel, Power of the Powerless, And he said, it begins in that hidden sphere, in the private sphere of life. And one of the proposals I have may seem a little quaint to folks, but I actually piloted a book club that was based entirely on the theme. Back then, we didn't call it the weaponization of loneliness, but propaganda, isolation, political correctness. And we read, there's a bibliography in the back of my book that gives some suggestions. And I think it would be great if book clubs could, or discussion groups, there's so many great articles and documentaries, and even, in addition to books, movies, where people could really get together and discuss these things. And I'm going to be talking more about that down the road. I'm hoping to write a guidebook for starting these kinds of clubs. But and then there's all kinds of little things we can do based on, what our situation is in life. But number one, just remember that free speech is use it or lose it. If you could just talk, get your toe in the water if you haven't done this before, and just talk to, say, one person who trusts you, but doesn't know really where you stand on an issue. Try to kind of break away from that fear of just expressing what you believe. And that's like the first challenge, getting your toe in the water to kind of break through the self-censorship. Somebody who trusts you, or just, is friendly, a neighbor, or whoever. And because there are three things that can happen as a result of that. Number one, you can find that you've emboldened a like-minded thinker. That's why things Hobble says, we don't really know what people believe, right, in a closed society. And there could be a lot of people, I've had people come up to me and whisper, yeah, I agree with you, but they don't want to tell anybody else. So we have to kind of break through that. And then the second thing that could happen if they don't know where you stand is you could be engaging a fence sitter. And that's very valuable. And then the third thing, and that's what we're all afraid of, is the person who's going to just get really angry and, disagrees with you. But what you've done there is you've watered down the stereotype, and that is worth so much more than we realize. People who, kind of expect you to be, this has happened to me a lot where people expect me to be a lefty. I mean, I was at one time, but, and they're just kind of surprised because I didn't fit their stereotype.
Right. So, you look so normal. You seem so nice.
Right. and that's what happens when you've got the spiral of silence going. Right, so right. Anyway, I don't know how specific, but mainly understand that free speech is use it or lose it. And that's what we need in order to develop relationships.
Right.
You can't have relationships if you can't talk to people,
right,
or you can't, express what you believe. And so remember that and then just cultivate that private sphere of life. Guard your families, your faith communities, the truth. Guard, whatever good community that you have. And understand that that's really the key to resisting, yes, all of this. That's a, yes, target.
Yes, exactly. And, I would go even further than what you just said to totally endorse your idea of book clubs. Actually, any kind of face-to-face meeting is of value. Okay, it doesn't matter what book you're reading. It doesn't matter what you're doing. It could be a play date with your kids. It's the fact that you're seeing people face-to-face.
Yes.
When you think about it, what the oligarchs are doing to us is making everything digital and everything electronic. Well, they can monitor all that, right? So if you're face to face, that's much harder, right? Anytime you have the choice between the digital or the face to face, the analog, the tangible, the material, you want to go for that, right? It doesn't even matter what you're doing. Oh, we're going to have a supper club. We're going to meet, we're going to meet once a week and have a potluck. It doesn't matter what you're talking about. The fact is you are engaging with other people in face to face. I noticed this during COVID when there got to be a point where, we were still locked down, but you were allowed to do certain things. It was like, why don't we all get together? It was like, okay.
Yeah.
Like, we're so eager to do that. It was like, it was a little bit, I don't know what's the word, like cloak and dagger, not quite cloak and dagger, but sort
Oh
of,
yeah, just kind
you
of,
know.
yeah, like you're sneaking off to do something. I know, but we didn't even get into that. And you're absolutely right. The whole digital revolution has created a whole new sense of alienation.
Right, right,
Cutting,
right.
especially with youth, cutting them off to such a, you know, huge part of their days from real face-to-face interactions. And I think a lot has been written about that,
Yes.
excessive screen time and all of that. But
Yes.
that you're
Yes.
right. That's another issue you could talk about for another hour.
Right. We could talk about it for another hour, but it goes right along with your very practical suggestion, right? That and
Oh,
everyone can do this, okay? People, everyone can cultivate some kind of face-to-face interactions with others. And I think number one, you'll find it rewarding personally. And number two, you can have this little, you know, sneaky rebellious thought in the back of your mind that you're doing your part to, you know, overturn the global oligarchy or whoever these people are, you know, that probably Klaus Schwab doesn't want you meeting your friends, but that's okay. Klaus doesn't get a vote at this point, right? You know, and Anthony Fauci and telling you whether you're allowed to have Thanksgiving and all the rest of this stuff, you know. We have every right to be in the same room with other human beings, right? And we have every need to be. We have every need to be.
And it's cruel to deny that.
Yes.
And to deny people, I mean, to, you know, to cover the children's faces in school.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, it's sadistic, really. I mean, when you think about the fact that this was not anything that children were really at risk for, you know, at
Right.
risk
Oh,
of.
taking the whole
And
thing together, the intellectual incoherence combined with the callousness, you know, the
yes.
callousness to the harms. The sociological and psychological harms that are, yeah, it's, I think some people are hardened in their position that it was all worthwhile and it was all good. And, you know, some people are like that, but for those who are not, for those who have any doubt at all, Stella's book is going to be really helpful to you. It's going to be really validating to you, right? It's going to be validating. And let me also say, if you want to do a book club or you want to do discussion group, you can use these videos, these Dr. J Show videos. We have a whole series on propaganda and censorship because
you
we
do,
have no
yeah.
experience with it. Actually, we've been on the receiving end of this, you know. So we've interviewed some very interesting people. And, you know, there's just the point is there's a lot of material out there. You don't have to worry about that part, right? You have to worry about who's bringing the roast beef and who's bringing the pickles. I mean, you know, that's the part you got to worry about. But there's a joy in that, you know, there's a joy in that face-to-face encounters, and anything we can do to cultivate it is truly radical and truly good. You know, dare we say it, something truly good. Stella, do
Good
you have
cheer.
any last words? Do you have any last words for us? Are you involved in any organizations or any place where you blog or write regularly where people could follow you and your work?
Oh, well, I'm a senior contributor to the Federalist, and so you can find my work there if you just go to thefederalist.com/author/Stella Morabito, one word. And I also have a blog, stellamorabito.net. I'm getting ready to move it over to Substack. I haven't done that yet, but I do have a personal blog, you know, and then I have my book. So right now that's what, you know, we're talking about. So I guess my final words would be, you know, be not afraid and be of good cheer.
Well,
and
Stella Morabito, that is a great place to end this very interesting conversation with you about your book and the weaponization of loneliness. And let's do everything we can to be a counter to that weaponization of loneliness. Thank you so much for your work and for your time.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.